all the Charlie toys were everywhere. Like, we got...
Kim, I'm live.
Y'all live?
Yeah. Big bro, how you doing, sir? Sorry, that shadow, and I know I'm dark skin. I apologize. Good evening, Kathy. How are you, darling? Good to see you back. Renee, one of my faithful students. Kaylin, how are you? Can't hear me. Cam, can you hear me now? Can y'all hear me? Hey, Toya. What's going on, Chris? Cam, can y'all hear me? Yvette can, okay. All right.
Can't hear you?
No, they can.
It's me, I'm back. Asta's on. Jasmine says, sorry, Ken, I can only afford hot dogs right now. Uh-oh, a lot of people can't hear. Is it not loud enough, y'all, or?
Some can, I don't know.
Hey, Michelle. Hey, Tiffany Mia. Okay, hey, H. How you feeling, Asta? Lolo, I'm ready with my spatchy spatch. Marche, did I say that right? Yay, there's my spatchy spatch. Just ready to stir, so just let me stir. Sound button. Oh, thank you, Lolo. The youth is helping me. She said, touch the sound button in the corner. Lolo, okay. I don't see no sound button, Lolo. Good. I'm glad you're feeling
better. She's talking to them.
Oh, if you can't hear. Got it. Okay. Hi, Tiffany Mia.
All right. So let's make sure everybody's oven is preheated to 350.
No, I want to pronounce your name the right way. Marchette. Chef Ken chooses the background music. It's kind of whatever he's in the mood for. That's what we listen to.
Who complained?
Three masks and cook. Really? Really? They did you like that, Asta? Brittany, you haven't missed anything. We're just getting started. Kind of letting a few more folks come in.
Make sure everybody preheats
the oven. Got it, Lolo. Say it again.
Make sure everybody's preheating your oven to 350.
Brandy, close out and come back in and see if that works, cousin. Good, Cam. Cam has sound now. He can see. It'll say that, but it does turn up your volume. Y'all listen to Lolo. She's younger than me, so she'll probably understand. Mon, I don't need you to tell me how to pronounce your name. Hi, Ellie. Jasmine, you definitely gave me a laugh today, girl. y'all. Please share the video. Share, share, share. Got our skillets on.
Once again, make sure your oven is preheated to 350, please. It's be very important for your salmon to cook.
Y'all have to, oh, thank you, Shelly, for recommending him to your family. Ellie, sorry. Y'all, I've, hold on, I'm trying to get this plugged in here. All right, you ready?
Yeah, let's get started.
Okay.
All right, guys, for today's class, the prep list is very light, just for the simple fact that we're going to elevate our game a little bit today. So,
is the skillet on?
I got it on low just because I keep it, I always keep my skillet on for ease of cooking. So it's on low right now.
So Elliot, it is on low just for him. I mean, you could probably do that too. What do you think?
I'm about speed, so I kind of keep everything ready to go.
Well, you gotta.
All right, so the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna get the salmon in the oven. So we have to first prepare our spinach. Now, for those who have already done your spinach, we're gonna stuff in it in just a second. But first, we're gonna take our first saute pan.
Jazz, there's a sound button. In the corner, click the sound button and turn it up and see if that works. If not, you might have to exit out and then come back in.
You can meet with others.
I mean, it's fun. I don't even. Hey, cousin.
So, 2 tablespoons of olive oil in a medium to hot saute pan. We're gonna add, I'm gonna say, a tablespoon of sun-dried tomatoes for each piece of salmon that you're stuffing. I like sun-dried, so I'm gonna add a little bit more for us. We're gonna add a teaspoon of our minced shallots and a teaspoon of our minced garlic. And then once that gets hot enough, we're going to saute it for about 2 to 3 minutes before we add our spinach, just to get our sun-dried tomatoes to cook down and heat up and soften up a little bit.
Hold on. What you need, auntie? That was a teaspoon of garlic, teaspoon of shallots, and the sun-dried tomatoes are based on how many pieces of salmon you're cooking.
So a tablespoon per, tablespoon of sun-dried tomatoes per salmon. Some of you are cooking for 4 and 5, some of you are cooking for just for yourself. So I'm not gonna tell you a quarter cup if it's only one person.
And I'm gonna start by, if anybody is new on here, guys, we do not post measurements, because we know that people's cooking sizes vary. So you might be cooking for one person, you could be cooking for more than one. And also, I think the goal for Chef Ken is to teach you how to
cook.
Cook.
So I'm gonna teach you basic steps that we're preparing recipes, but essentially I'm teaching you how to cook in your home for you and your family. My taste buds and my liking for my family might vary from yours. We like a little bit more spice and heavy seasoning food, where some people might be, depending on dietary restrictions or whatnot, you may not be able to consume the same things that we are consuming. Like sun-dried tomatoes are a very acquired taste. We like sun-dried tomatoes, so we'll add a little bit more because that's what we like. If you don't, add a little bit less, just to have enough to get in and get the flavor of the tomatoes for your dish. But I'm overall teaching you how to cook. So once we start getting some flavor going, you're starting to get the aromatics of the garlic and shallots. Sun-dried tomatoes are starting to loosen up. And please make sure your oven is on 350.
Yes, until he put olive oil in the pan. Lolo, I love your commentary. Period.
All right. So now that we started getting a little bit of color, as you can start to see, I'm getting a little char, a little sear on my sun-dried tomatoes. I added just a touch more oil because we're about to add in our spinach. I'm using fresh picked baby spinach. No wrong spinach, as long as it's not frozen. And so we're gonna wilt the spinach down. Depending on your pan size, just fill up your pan. And then we're gonna add just a touch of stock.
Thank you, Carissa. Sounds like applause going off right there. Why wouldn't you want to use frozen spinach?
Because frozen spinach has already been cooked, and so once you heat it back up, the amount of water it's gonna emit, it's not gonna offer the same thing we want for this dish. So we don't wanna add. Spinach is already a very watery product. Once you see when we cook it, how much moisture we'll push out of the spinach before we stuff it. But frozen spinach is gonna have way too much water for you. And then for this dish, it's not gonna offer as much flavor.
How much stock would you say you just added in there?
Maybe 2 tablespoons, just enough to keep the pan from burning. Get a little moisture in there. It's gonna wilt down.
So just a touch, Brittany. He didn't add much.
Yeah. So all we're doing is just kind of wilting the spinach. You still want some texture. You still want the leaf to be kind of somewhat visible. You don't want it overcooked.
Cam, that was stock. Pour your stock in. Yes, Lolo.
And then I'm just gonna take my mixture. We're gonna dump it into a bowl. Like I said, in your prep list, some of you have already done this, which is fine. A little easier since your spinach is cold. We're gonna put that to the side. We're gonna remove. So I'm gonna push it up. You just see, even though we added some stock.
Yes, stock.
Spinach is already gonna emit a lot of water. So I'm gonna pour that off.
So in a skillet, he sauteed a tablespoon of garlic, shallots, the tomatoes, right? Sun-dried tomatoes based on how many pieces of salmon you have. And then he added in the spinach and before, and then right after that, he added in a little bit of the stock just to stop it from burning. So it wasn't much. He just added in a little bit to stop the, so the spinach and the sun-dried tomatoes wouldn't burn.
So, go ahead and get your spinach sauteed off with your sun-dried tomatoes. All I'm doing now is just squeezing the spinach.
Yep, we got you, Brittany. We're going to hold on for a second. Let y'all catch up. Saute your spinach.
Like I said, we got a lot of moving parts today, so we will slow down and let you guys catch up. So as of now, I'm doing is keep taking my spinach.
Just kind of pushing it against the...
I'm just pushing against the wall of the bowl. Just trying to get as much moisture out as possible. How's everybody doing? Wine break, my favorite part.
Well, so, I'm gonna do my best today to be a good camera person.
Okay, see you, girl. So really, like I said, guys, we're gonna kind of elevate our game this week. Please, if we're moving too fast, just say stop and slow down and we can revisit what you need help on. We're gonna stuff with salmon. We're gonna make some pan roasted asparagus. We've already done our wild rice. And then we're gonna make a lemon butter sauce made from our own room that we're gonna make. So, there'll be a lot going on today. Class will be a little bit longer.
Ellie, he poured it out. Just drained it.
Yeah. So, what you want is to get to the point where you're getting nothing in your bowl.
No moisture.
No moisture. If you're feeling pretty good, give us a thumbs up.
Give us a like.
I see what you did there.
Y'all. Oh, he stopped. I was going to try to show y'all. Okay, it looks like everybody's doing good. All right, I think we're ready, Chef.
All right. So next up, we're going to season our spinach. I'm going to start my little kosher salt. Spinach is a very delicate vegetable, so it doesn't take much on the seasoning. Just enough to get, you know what you talk about. That seasoned pepper every week. So kosher salt, seasoned pepper, and then your garlic blend, depending on what you like. This week we're gonna use our Mrs. Dash garlic and herb. Sometimes we rotate that with our Weber roasted garlic and herb. And then depending on your dietary restrictions, Kroger makes a pretty good garlic and blend that's salt-free as well. So your choice of what you prefer for you. That's what we're doing. So now I'm going to add the cheese to our spinach.
Darren's on.
A half a cup of mozzarella. Quarter cup of Parmesan cheese.
Could this vary?
It can.
Like if they're cheese lovers?
You know, some people have dietary restrictions, so you want to cut back. If you like cheese, we're not using cream cheese, so it's going to ooze a little bit. I'm just not a big fan of cream cheese and salmon. But if you want to bind it, if you feel like it's going to be too loose, you can add some breadcrumbs to this mixture. We'll hold it together.
Yeah, Brittany, you just seasoned it up however you liked. Chef used kosher salt, pepper blend, and seasoned pepper, and then a garlic blend. So he's just seasoning up that spinach.
And then right here, we probably could add some crushed red pepper for a little heat, or cayenne, depending on your preference.
Thank you, Lolo.
So we're gonna add a little bit of crushed red pepper. Can't go wrong with spice. So now that we got our mixture, like I said, if you feel like, because we're not adding any cream cheese, that this is not thick enough for you, or it's gonna kinda ooze out, you're able to use some breadcrumbs if you have it. But we're good on that over here. So, one big habit I want you to get in a habit of doing is also tasting your food as you're seasoning it. Is it to your liking? What's the flavor profile? Because only you know what you and your family like. So I'm gonna touch it up just a little.
Got two on the Yes Teats. Add that crushed red pepper, y'all. Both cheeses, yes. He did a
half a cup of mozzarella, quarter cup of Parmesan.
Half a cup mozzarella, quarter cup Parmesan. gonna mix it all in, taste it. If you feel like you need to add more salt, the
pepper, spice,
add it in. Now's the time to do it. Asta, are you all right over there? They made her wear 3 masks and made her still get in the kitchen and cook.
All right, so next up, we're gonna use that same pan. We're turning on medium heat. 2 tablespoons of olive oil, and we're gonna prepare our salmon. Slide around. So there are a few ways that we can attack this salmon. Move that out the way.
Okay, girl. Let us know if you need us to slow down, okay? Anybody, let us know.
And once again, I'm going to reiterate the different cutting boards that we have, because you want to try to keep your raw and your ready-to-eat products separately. So depending on what kind of salmon you got, well, I'm not going to say kind, the cut, thick cut is going to be the best cut for us today to stuff it.
What if the mixture is too salty? The spinach and cheese mixture that they just created.
If you have any more spinach, you can saute some spinach to add to it. If you don't have any spinach, I would add either some breadcrumbs or a touch of vinegar. Balsamic or red wine vinegar will cut the acidity. Cut the saltiness of that.
Oh, wow. But they need you to take a wine break.
Okay.
You can tell the regulars.
Who said wine break?
Auntie Kim. Half a cup of mozzarella, quarter cup of Parmesan. Did you get that? Half a cup of mozzarella. Do you have a pan on the stove getting hot right now?
Yes, we do.
Same pan we just used, guys.
We got it on medium heat. And we're going to use that just to sear the salmon before we put it in the oven. And once again, your oven should be on 350. Make sure you have a pan, a sheet tray, or whatever pan you're going to put your salmon on, and line it with foil. So this is what... So this is what we're going to throw our salmon on after we sear it and stuff it. And we'll finish it in the oven.
So that's just a sheet tray with foil, guys, that he has to put in the oven.
Make sure your skillet is not getting too hot for those who have turned your heat up to medium.
Yeah, if you are ready to go to the next step and you're kind of just waiting, what should they do? What should be the next? Should they take it off the heat or just kind of reduce the heat?
Yeah, cut down a little bit. You're good as long as your oil's not smoking. All right, guys. So next up is our salmon. As you can see, I got a different cutting board. I'm going to reiterate that with a raw product.
Where do we get these from? Was that IKEA we got these?
We got these from IKEA, and I know Home Goods and some of your TJ Maxx.
It was like 3 in a set.
So we got green, yellow, blue, and red for your major meats and your produce. So depending on the thickness of your salmon, we're going to cut it a few different ways. Whatever you're most comfortable with works best for you. So I have a thin cut right here. That's probably maybe 1 inch thick. So I'm not gonna go on the side of it. I'm gonna stuff that straight down the middle. So we're making an incision straight down the middle of the salmon. Probably about 1/4 inch from the ends.
And then I'm just gonna kind of open up the middle some more with a horizontal cut.
Hey, check out hers from Amazon. You know, we love our Amazon. You can go on there and get you a set of cutting boards.
It's all we're doing is basically making a pocket. And that's where we're gonna put our stuffing in. And so we'll leave that kind of like that. That's for my thin cut. We got a really thick cut right here. But because of the shape, that was an end piece, I'm gonna make a pocket. So I'm gonna go halfway to where the taper side of the salmon is. So this is the belly side because it's smaller, that's the tapered end. So we're not gonna be able to stuff that because it's too thin. So we're gonna stay right here inside the body of it. And we're gonna go straight into the salmon. And if you don't have a sharp knife, this is gonna be tough for you guys. So every week we talk about the essentials, and a sharp knife is very important to the culinarian. So I'm just taking my knife and I'm making a incision, and I'm not really going back and forth. I'm just taking it, and right now I'm saying about an inch and a half in, and I'm just rotating it around the inside of the salmon and coming back out. So as you see, we had a nice deep pocket. And if that's too much, I understand. We're gonna take the classical way and we'll just take a horizontal cut and we'll go.
Hey Orlando, your shirt should be arriving this week. Welcome back.
We're gonna create a flap. So leaving about a quarter of an inch, and we're gonna open it up like that. So that's three different ways we're gonna stuff the salmon. Depending on your knife and your skill set and what you're comfortable with, you choose. So first and foremost, we're gonna season our salmon. Everything always gets seasoned.
Our nurse on the chat says that she loves how you say incision.
So kosher salt. Seasoned pepper. And so right here, guys, this is we're gonna kind of stop. Season your salmon up. And before we stuff it, because oven roasting doesn't give it that nice, beautiful color that we're looking for, we're just gonna pan sear it real quick just to give some color on top of the flesh before we stuff it and finish it in the oven.
Okay.
Because we want that nice golden brown color for presentation purposes. And when you bite, it gives it a little crispy texture and some different texture because the stuffing will be soft. So we would need some crispness, something to crunch on a little bit. So we're gonna go right into the hot saute pan. The residuals from your spinach is okay. And as we have discussed beforehand, when you're laying anything in hot grease, you always lay away from you. So if it splatters, it splatters away from you. And if you made the incision on top side, you put the bottom side in first. You wouldn't want to see that pocket closed.
Oh. You okay, Cam? You got it.
So take your time. We'll take another wine break. And all I'm doing is getting some color on my salmon.
Okay, chef.
We're just getting some color on that salmon, and then we're gonna pull it right back off.
So I know some of y'all are cutting up a couple of pieces, quite a few pieces. So we're just kind of gonna take a wine break and let y'all catch up. Don't forget to make your pocket in your salmon before you drop it into your skillet to get color. Oh, your mama's on. Hey, Nana.
Hey, Mama.
Ooh. I'm gonna drop the phone. Sorry, y'all. It is the margarita. The camera lady has been drinking margarita tonight.
I have to do a little quarantine because you can do what you want. Why? Because that's your business.
Tabitha Brown, my favorite. That's your business.
All right, so we're going to work our pan around.
Looking for a good color. I'm gonna go a little bit longer.
Hi, Auntie Carnet. I'm glad you're joining us tonight. So are you holding it up like that because you kind of want to sear it on all sides of the...
Yeah, because we can't sear the top of it because we have our incisions or our pocket up there. I'm just going to get some cover on the sides of it. Make sure you got plenty of oil. I want to make sure it's kind of bubbling.
Yes, girl.
As you see, guys, I prefer the skin on my salmon. It looks good. But make sure if you're touching this salmon, guys, we are washing our hands.
And then remind us again, this piece is face up because of, or?
Because of the pocket that we incision, because it's top. A smaller piece and we can't really make a pocket. So we're going to stuff the top of it. So we made three different ways you can stuff a salmon. And once you get a good color on yours, we're going to pull it off. Guys, it's gonna take y'all some time, so we'll go slow.
Yeah. Does anyone have any questions that they want Chef to answer? Now is kind of like the perfect time.
So
while we're giving everybody else a chance to catch up.
So for the one we're top stuffing, I'm gonna say this.
Oh, Brittany, you're fine, sweetheart. It's fine if it's still cooking.
Yeah, I'm gonna give you, and we're gonna go in the oven. So depending on what size of the salmon in your pocket. It's a low to enough to where it's not making the salmon kind of explode. Because we're still going to lose some moisture. It is stuffed, but it's still salmon. So we want more salmon than stuffing.
Hi, Rico. You join us every week. Are you cooking with us this week?
So
all he did, y'all, was sear the salmon just to kind of give it a little bit of color. Here, I'm going to show you this piece. Just to kind of give a little bit of color before he stuffs it. Mine is a side incision. Should I brown on all sides?
No. Keep the side open so your incision stays open.
So sear on every side except for that
yes.
side with the incision.
Because you won't be able to open it back up.
No skin on mine.
That's not an issue. That was just a preference that we like.
Side incision should be face down in the pan. That's Lolo giving her commentary.
Should not be.
Should not be, Lolo. Side incision should not be face down in the pan.
So you're kind of
take that. Like mega stuffed over there.
Yeah.
Thanks, Rico. Send us pictures. Make sure when you cook it, if you cook it on the weekend, still send us pictures. Tag Ken in it.
So once you get your salmon stuffed, we're going to go in the oven for about 15 to 20 minutes.
It's okay, Lolo. So he just went on ahead and stuffed his, y'all. Oh, you're asking. Okay, did you get the answer, Lolo? It should not be face down. Turn around this way so y'all can kind of see how he stuffed that. This was the piece that was...
The flap.
Okay, you just basically cut it down the middle.
A vertical incision. We left about a quarter of an inch off the salmon so we don't cut it all the way open. And we just kind of big boy stuffed that one. This one was a pocket we made, but I cooked it a little bit too long, so the top is kind of, it's already cooked a little bit longer, so it's kind of flaky, so it's kind of tearing a little bit. Won't mess with the flavor or the complexity of the dish, it just presentation purposes. And then this is probably the most common use everybody's gonna use today, is the top cut, where we're stuffing the top of the salmon and not the side.
Does this count as keto?
It does.
Hey, Renee, it does. John Wilder, what is the stuffing ingredients? He just joined, so he's asking what was the stuffing.
So we did our take on a Mediterranean stuff. So we sauteed sun-dried tomatoes with shallots and garlic. We added in fresh picked baby spinach. And then we cooled that down and we added mozzarella cheese and Parmesan cheese.
You're okay, Auntie. We're slowing down because you know you're cooking for a family.
Wine break.
Wine break. I can't have any more margarita breaks.
That's gonna be old.
John, did you get that? You need He did. Okay, good. Just want to make sure you got it. Tierra, are you not cooking with us this week?
Who was that?
Tierra Williams. She said it sounds so good. Okay, good deal. All
right, guys, if you're in a good spot, give us a thumbs up or a like.
Give us a like. If you're doing great, give us a like. If you need more time, give us a caring hug. Did you put oil on this sheet pan, Chef?
I did not.
He did not.
But also I have skin, so my skin's going to emit oil from it.
Okay, good. Auntie Yvette, where are you? So is yours still browning or are you finally at the stuffing?
You can pick up your salmon for those who don't have a skin on and you just kind of lightly oil your...
Okay, so this is for if they don't have skin on. If they have skin, they don't need to do this step? Okay.
Because your skin's going to emit enough oil to keep it from sticking. So I'm
going to lightly. Okay, good deal. All
right.
Okay, we still got a couple folks that are kind of browning their salmon before they start stuffing it. I'm just gonna keep the camera on the salmon, y'all.
Yeah, get that salmon because next part is gonna be the sauce.
Everybody that's joining in, thank you guys for joining in. Thank you for watching. John Wilder, I figured that you were a cousin of Cam. I'm a cousin too, John. So, hey, cousin. I'm a cousin on his mom's side. Okay, Chef.
Well, you said wine break.
I used a whole fish, so I'm in the oven. Is that okay?
Yeah.
Okay.
But did you stuff it already?
I think she stuffed it. Can you cook the salmon medium with the stuffing?
Yeah. So I'm usually going to look for an internal temperature of 145 for the salmon. It's going to be a little harder to check with the stuffing, but the internal temperature comes right under the stuffing or the temperature of the stuffing, not the salmon.
Hold on. Is skin on more flavorful?
Yes, my being. Because it holds in the fat and that, and the fat and the omega-3 acids of the salmon. And so if it cooks, it kind of disperses into it and keeps that moisture locked in.
Any more questions? Raquita, hi, you're new. I've never seen your name before. Welcome. Hey, Alexis. Looking good, Chef.
Thank you, girl.
That's from your mama. I'm awesome. Thank you, girl. Y'all, excuse our cabinets. I decided to get adventurous and try to paint our cabinet. Hopefully, that'll be done by next week.
All right. So, once your salmon is in
hey, Mika.
The oven, we're going to venture to our next step, and we're going to make our lemon caper butter sauce. And we're going to start with the base of every sauce, or most sauces, is called a roux. So, when you're creating a roux, it's basically fat and flour. We're going to use butter today. We can use oil as well, but butter emits the best flavor.
So depending on how much sauce you're making, roux is R-O-U-X. So there'll be a few culinary terms today. Roux is very important to your sauce or chowders, gumbos, certain things that we've created, bechamels, which is your cheese sauce that you make for macaroni and cheese, stuff like that. All those come from a base of roux. Now, if you're trying to be gluten-free, and you don't want to use flour, you can use cornstarch to make a slurry or arrowroot. Two options. But for the sake of that, we're not gluten-free. We're using flour, we're using butter, and we're going to make the sauce right. So for every cup of broth,
yes, Cam, the fish is in the oven now. So once you have browned it, you're going to stuff it, and then you're going to place it in the oven. So once you've stuffed it with your mixture, place it in the oven.
And we're going about 15 minutes in the oven,
which will give us enough time to make our
roux.
Roux.
So we're going to start with butter and flour. We're going to turn our sauce pot on medium heat. And when you're making your roux, you have three types of roux. You have a white roux, which we're gonna cook the flour for about 2 to 3 minutes just to get the flavor taste out of that before we add our liquid or our broth. You have a blonde roux, which you're gonna cook about seven to eight minutes, which is more of caramel color, a little nuttier flavor. And then you have your chocolate roux or your brown roux, which people use in gumbo, which generally you take and you cook flour for about 30 minutes. To get that deep, nutty chocolate flavor. And they say when you're making a roux or a gumbo, if you're not sweating in the pot, it's not dark enough. So we're gonna start with 2 tablespoons of flour. We're gonna melt that with 2 tablespoons of butter. And so this is gonna create us about a cup and a half of sauce.
So you did 2 tablespoons of flour?
Yes.
To 2 tablespoons of butter?
Yes, and these are exact measurements because your roux is not something we're gonna test with. You want exactly know exactly what you want and how you wanna get it. So, but like I said, we're making about a cup and a half of sauce. Make sure you have a whisk because you want to be able to get into the corners of your sauce pot and make sure there is no flour.
Thank you, Alexis.
There is no flour sticking, like right there. You want to make sure you get all that up. And we're just going to melt this butter and this flour. And we're going to cook it 2 to 3 minutes. And this is all white roux. Now, if you cook for more people and you need more sauce, add in 2 more tablespoons of flour and 2 more tablespoons of butter and melt all that down.
So how much would you say that this serving is for?
This would be for 3 to 4 people.
3 to 4 people.
And this is just to put sauce over the salmon. I'm not making my salmon soup. If you're a heavy soup person, I'm sorry, heavy sauce person, you might want to add a touch more. And I would do 3 tablespoons of flour to 3 tablespoons of butter. So you can always add a little bit more. But once we add that liquid.
Thanks, Tamika. Your sister's on. She said, looking good.
Once we add the liquid, we can only add flour and butter. We'd have to change and add a slurry. And your slurry, which we've done in the past, is your cornstarch and water. Or what some people should be doing now if they're not using flour because they're gluten-free. So make sure that you are getting all areas of your sauce pot. Scrape down the sides.
Auntie Yvette, that's 2 tablespoons of flour and 2 tablespoons of butter. And he's just kind of whisking it together.
And we're going to start the seasoning kind of thicken up. It's starting to boil a little bit. That's that flour coming together. And all we're doing, like I said, we're cooking it 2 to 3 minutes just to boil out the flavor of the flour.
Yeah,
You don't want that chalky taste.
Cam, this liquid right here. The sauce that you're making to pour on top. That's it. Yep. Butter and flour. That's perfect.
All right, she's starting to see it thicken up. It's starting to boil. We're going to add a cup of stock, chicken, or vegetable.
Their choice. Either one will do. Mm-hmm. Okay. Gluten-free kids like slurries. True.
Yeah.
True.
I added more. So if you just did the regular recipe...
And how much stock did you just add?
Half a cup. Because we did three tablespoons.
Add a half a cup of stock.
And so we're using a roux. It's only going to get thick once the liquid gets hot. So I'm probably seeing a really watery pot right now, which is fine. You just add it in cold broth. And then we're going to add in a quarter cup of the heavy cream. That's going to give it just a little body, a little flavor, some more fat to it. And we're going to turn it up a little. We're going to turn it up to medium high. And we want this to boil.
Auntie Kim, what did yours look like? She said hers didn't look like yours. Tell us what it looked like. Describe it so we can kind of help you get to where you want to be.
So if it was too thick and looked like paste, you had too much flour and not enough butter. You could add butter or olive oil. And if it was too watery and not bubbling, you added too much fat and not enough flour.
Brittany, he just added in stock. So you can do chicken stock or you can do vegetable stock. And he did a half a cup.
No.
Oh.
We did a cup of stock.
Sorry. A cup of stock.
And a quarter cup of heavy cream.
Oh, I need to go fix that then.
And we're going to bring that to a boil.
Excuse me. One cup of stock, y'all. We trying, Mika girl. We trying. I'm going to add that in here for the comments so people can just easily look back and see it. One cup of stock.
Quarter cup of heavy cream. And once again, same thing, guys. We want to make sure we're still stirring our sauce, not letting that flour sit in any corners. Don't want that to burn.
Hey, Jackie. For our friends that are not using heavy cream because they are lactose intolerant or they just cannot do dairy, so you would it be the same measurements? Or
you want to substitute coconut milk, but I would do very little. You just want to get the creaminess of that. Or you can do straight stock, and that's called a velouté. So velouté is another one of our mother sauces, and that basically is stock that is thickened with the roux. So you don't need cream at all.
So Cam, that's for you. You don't have to add a coconut milk. You could just do the stock. Brittany says that hers is really thick. What should she add in?
You start adding more stock. But remember, guys, for every table, if you did the 2 tablespoons of flour and 2 tablespoons of butter, you should have added in 1 cup of stock and a quarter cup of cream.
That sounds gonna drive me crazy.
This. So as you can see, it's starting to kind of thicken up a nice smooth consistency. It's not quite there yet. It's going to keep thickening up.
Cam said his looks like applesauce.
Oh, Cam, just add more stock.
I'm trying, Brandy. I'm trying to get better. I'm trying to add the notes in. She says she likes that.
So I'm starting to get some, like I said, layers and waves. You can start seeing the thickness and the strokes of the whisk. That's how you know it's thickening up. If you can't tell that way.
Sorry. Did that $10 come to me? Thank you, girl.
So if you really want to start seeing the thickness of your sauce, grab a spoon, and then if we coast the back of the spoon, we're doing good. And so we talked about the viscosity or the viscous of the sauce last week. It's not running. We're doing good. And as you can see, now mine's starting to boil.
Cam, did you add the stock? How did it do? Hey, Santana.
So once you get to a nice boil, you're starting to see the layers. We're going to cut that down. We're going to add lemon juice. So we're going to add a generous tablespoon of lemon juice. 2 tablespoons of lemon juice.
Oh, Lord.
We're gonna add.
We hear you, Ty. That was lemon juice he just added. A generous portion of lemon juice. What would you consider a generous portion?
2 tablespoons.
2 tablespoons.
I'm gonna add 2 tablespoons of capers. We love the brine of the capers, so we're gonna add some of that brine with it. And then now we're adding some fresh chopped parsley.
You did 2 tablespoons of capers, Chef, with the brine?
Yes.
Cam, tell us what's wrong. What do we need to do to fix it? Got to describe it to us. That helps us out a lot when we can
because you might not be the only person having the same issue.
Yeah, I'm saying we, but I really mean Chef. How much parsley are you adding to that?
You don't know. I'll start with a tablespoon. See what it looks like. So a good thing to look at your sauce too is if you're stirring your sauce and you kind of see the capers are cascading through the sauce, they're not falling to the bottom, you know you got a great consistency of your sauce. Now, if everything's kind of falling, you kind of see they're kind of hanging out. You still see them sitting up in the sauce. We're at a great spot.
Cam went from applesauce to mashed potatoes.
Okay, yeah, way too much flour. So you got to add more stock. You can even add a little wine or water.
2 tablespoons of lemon juice. Kaylee. Yes, Tamika, he is over there getting to it. Hey, Teron. We got quite a few of our friends saying that theirs is actually thick.
So you just add enough stock.
So should they just keep adding stock until they get to it better?
Slowly adding stock. I would keep adding it by a quarter cup until it gets to consistency. But as you saw, we measured it out. And so if we did the 2 tablespoons of flour, the 2 tablespoons of butter, a cup of stock, and a quarter cup of heavy cream, you should be good to go. But if it's too thick, we're just going to keep adding more stock.
What part, Renee? I also put it in the comments. No, Vimahi has not added any wine. He's just drinking the wine. Brandy said, Kimmy, help your mom, please. We have not added wine yet. And I've also put in the comments, guys, like, what he's added to this sauce here.
Now we're adding our fresh parsley.
So this started off as
our roux.
A roux.
Flour and butter. 2 tablespoons of each. We cooked that for about 3 minutes to cook the flour flavor or taste out of the roux. We added a cup of stock and a quarter cup of heavy cream. Stop.
It's just hard to hear what the whisk going to.
Oh, so we added a cup of stock and a quarter cup of heavy cream. And we whisk continuously for about 4 minutes. And now we're cooking on low. We added 2 tablespoons of lemon juice, 2 tablespoons of capers with the brine, and our parsley. We have not seasoned it yet, but that's where we're at. So now we're just looking for that great consistency.
And whisk it fast.
Whisk it fast.
Whisk it fast.
At the corners and the walls to make sure you don't get the flour sticking or burning.
Oh, sorry. 2 tablespoons of capers, auntie. Thank you, Tamika, because you know I am not tech savvy. Oh, look at that. Tamika has just helped me. I've learned something new. She taught me how to pin my comment so that they can see it. Thanks, Tamika.
All right, will you move your spatchy spatch out of the way?
Y'all got my spatula ready.
All right, guys, so now we're taking our salmon. Keep going on your sauce. But I don't want to forget about our salmon.
Oh my God, that looks so good.
So salmon's coming out of the oven. You see we didn't need the cream. We got a good firmness to our salmon. You see a little of the white is coming out. It means it's done around the edges. So we're good here. And so we're going to let that rest.
Forget you, Lolo. Samaya, welcome.
Mohammed.
Yeah.
Hey, Samaya.
She's new. Oh, welcome.
So, guys, we'll come back to the sauce. I know we're kind of not used to making a sauce from scratch. But once you learn this technique, it'll change your game. So, we're coming back. Like I said, no flour sticking on the bottom of the pan. We have the parsley and capers cascading through the sauce. So, we're sitting up. It's not falling to the bottom. It's not overly thick. It's not watering. So, depending on what's going on with your sauce, we can fix it. It happens all the time.
Cam, tell us what your sauce is looking like.
So, if your sauce is too thick, it means it feels like mud or slush, and one person mashed potatoes, it doesn't have enough liquid. If it's too thin, we'll probably come back and add a slurry to that because we added too much liquid. But the one thing about sauces is they can be fixed.
Samaya, hopefully one day we'll get there. She says you need a YouTube channel. Sharikia, he did 1 tablespoon of parsley. He started off with a tablespoon of parsley, I guess I should say. Braxton Ward, hey, welcome. I've never seen you.
Hey, chef, how are you?
Oh, it's a chef. Hey, now. Nana says she's coming to get hers after class.
Okay. I don't know where to be, but come on.
That's his mom, y'all.
chef don't care.
He did like that.
Wine break. So give us some feedback, guys. How you feeling right now? We're actually pretty close to being done.
Cam got to stay after school.
We got to do a house party call, Cam.
He wants to be in your video. Can we add him in so we can see what his sauce looks like? Okay. Cam, we're adding you in. Luke Jackson, hey.
What's up, Luke?
Okay. Let's see what's going on with his sauce. That might help somebody else who might be going through the same thing.
Know
all right, he's adding now.
Okay, I'm really behind, y'all. Hold on.
Okay, we're adding you in. Jackson, hey.
It looks like mashed potatoes.
All right, where's your stuff? Add your stuff. No, keep it from the camera. Keep it up.
Huh?
Keep it up. Keep it up. All right. Start whisking it. Thank you, Ellie. Your room.
I can't hear you say what?
No, keep stirring. Keep stirring. Add some more stuff.
Add some more.
Stop.
Oh.
Now, Cameron, you use butter.
Huh?
You use flour and butter, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Now it looks like a couple lemon juice. I'm just gonna catch up after the class. I don't want to hold too many people behind.
All right, no worries. That boil, and once it starts boiling, tell me what it looks like.
All right, yeah, I'll catch you after the class.
All right. All right, guys. So you see,
if there's any questions, we'll bring you in and help you out. Like I said, it's about teaching and not just about making one dish. I want you guys to know how to fix your stuff at home, your family.
can't go in there on Cam. Y'all, I love my family.
They have all right, so how we feeling? Everybody get a point? Our sauce was good. We didn't taste it yet, so now we're going to taste our sauce. See what we need. And once again, we're talking about the complexity of the sauce. It's got a good body. It's coating the back of a spoon.
It's bitter. Does that mean they added too much brine from the capers?
Maybe, but we haven't seasoned it yet. I prefer a little more lemon juice in mine. So about another tablespoon. If it's too bitter, you don't like the brine of it, you can add lemon juice. You can add a touch more stock, or you can probably add a quarter cup of your Chardonnay. That'll cut a little bit as well. So I'm gonna add kosher salt to mine. I'm not gonna add any spice because we put some spice in our Mediterranean stuffing. A little garlic blend. And then our seasoned pepper. Let's keep it with that. Bring it all together. You see how the sauce has a really good body? That means when we put it on top of that, or nappe the salmon, another culinary word, nappe, it's gonna sit there. It's not gonna run. It's not gonna pull all over the place. It's gonna have great consistency. We're gonna taste this again.
So for anybody wondering, we're not posting measurements for the seasoning. So he kind of put his sauce together. Oh, okay.
You guys kind of do a little one time. Oh, I'm sorry.
He tasted his sauce. He determined that it needed a little bit more lemon juice, a couple more seasoning, and that's what he did. He just seasoned it to his liking.
I'm happy.
Hey, Misha.
Pull that thing up good. I need a wine break on that one alone. Good job, Chef.
Oh, my God. You patting yourself on the back? You're patting yourself on the back.
Okay. Hold on, let me turn this way so you can see. Good job, Chef.
Oh, my God. Okay.
That sauce is good.
Okay.
All right. Enough. So now that we are good with our salmon.
How do you dilute the lemon flavor?
Stock.
Stock. Stock seems to be the answer to a lot of questions that we have on here today.
Yes. Because that's overly the base of the sauce. The roux is your thickening agent, which thickens it and makes it the how thin or thick it is. But over the flavor is coming from the stock, because that's all we're using. Whether you use vegetable stock, chicken broth, that's where your flavor is coming from. And then we're just kind of tempering the flavor with lemon juice and capers to give it that Mediterranean feel. From the salty and tanginess of the brine to the acid of the lemon and the flavoring, which will pair really well with the tartness of the sun-dried tomatoes and the spinach.
That's that Texan in them. That's what Lolo said.
What does that mean, Lolo? All right, so if you already blanched your asparagus, blanching means we are cooking quickly in boiling salted water. That way, it brings out the brightness of the vegetable. It makes for ease of cooking. So when we cook our asparagus, we're only going to pick it up in a hot saute pan with garlic for like 2 minutes. Here, we're done. So that's going to be the last thing we do. Next, if you already cooked off your wild rice, we're going to pick up the wild rice. We're going to start with in a hot saute pan or skillet, depending on your verbiage.
Chrissy Andrews, hi.
Hey, my favorite person in the world. So my pan is on medium heat. Just a light oil, maybe a tablespoon. We're bringing in some fresh shallots. You hear that sizzle already, so you know it's hot. All we're doing is getting those shallots fragrant and soft.
How are y'all doing out there? Is everybody in a good place?
I promise you, we only got about 5-10 more minutes and we're done. Are you ready to eat? So, bringing our shallots up, we're going to add in some fresh parsley. Where's my fatty fetch? I'm going to move that around a little bit. And now, we're going to add in our wild rice.
Auntie Bat, that is shallots.
oil and parsley.
Oil and parsley.
Hey, all you do is bring up the shallots till they're a little translucent and aromatic. You smell them. Then we're going to toss in our wild rice. Depending on how many people you're feeding, I would say a half a cup per person. We're going to bring this to temperature. And now this is where it gets fun, guys. We're going to take it, and we're going to do just a small lap around the pan or a Chardonnay. And let that wine infuse in our rice. So if you look at the pan, I didn't put enough to where it's swimming in wine, but enough to keep the pan from sizzling. And we're gonna bring that rice to temperature in that wine and infuse that flavor. Now I'm not gonna add any salt to my wild rice. You can if you like. But I think from the Chardonnay and the shallots, we're good. So I'm gonna add a touch of my pepper.
Renee, you not cooking?
Renee, you're fired. And then for those who want a little more texture, creamy texture to your rice, you can also add a little bit of butter, which pair really well with that wine. And we're gonna bring that to temperature. Cook all that wine out. Make sure it is infused into your rice.
Hi, Sharon. Thanks for joining.
How are y'all feeling, guys? I know it's a lot going on today, a lot of moving parts. But I told you, it's time for you guys to step up to the next level. So I think we're doing a great job. If you're cooking rice right now, you should feel really great about what you're doing.
Kaylee, in that skillet, he added shallots, olive oil. He let them cook until they were fragrant. Added parsley. And then he added his rice and then a little bit of a Chardonnay.
Y'all don't hear my wife being culinary. You know, we're talking about fragrant.
I do better with it. Here's the drinks that I deal out.
She might be able one day putting that spatchy spatch down, guys. All right. So, as you see, rice started thickening up. There's absolutely no moisture left in that pan. Yes, I am using a non-stick pan, so I'm not worried about it sticking. If you're sticking, add some more oil.
Yeah, Kaylee, he seasoned it to taste. Season it however you
so I didn't add any more salt, Kaylee. Right? I didn't add any salt, but I did add pepper in and a little bit of our garlic blend. All right, guys, for you guys, you can take this pan and put it to the side or wherever you like. Bring out a fresh pan. I'm going to go ahead and start plating up, because that's what I want to do. And we're going to do the experiment.
That's my business. That's what Tabitha Brown was saying.
Tabitha Brown about cooking.
That's my business.
So we're going to move our beautiful salmon out the way.
How y'all doing?
It's a busy class today, guys. I understand. Keep asking questions. So we're actually gonna pull this to the side, set it over here. One more pan on medium heat. I promise it's the last thing we're doing. Olive oil to coat.
Wait.
Who that is?
That's literally what Auntie Kim said. Wait.
All right, Auntie Kim, where you at?
Get into chef mode. He starts moving a little fast, y'all.
Sorry, guys. This is what
he gets into chef mode. And
see that? Smiling. Who told me to smile last week? I smiled. That's all you get. Back to my wine break. So let's kind of review what we've done so far. You've stuffed the salmon. You pan-seared it. We baked it in the oven. we made our house, homemade lemon butter caper cream from a fresh white roux that you made by yourself. We added stock, lemon juice, capers, and parsley. You seasoned it to your liking and your family's liking. We just picked up our wild rice, which means we just brought it to temperature and getting it ready to plate. So we added shallots, parsley, and Chardonnay to our rice, which looks beautiful over here. You see the skin coming off. It's not mushy. You still can see the individual grains of the wild rice. You see the different colors of rice. You see the black rice in there. So, beautiful looking rice. And now we're about to finish with the asparagus in about 3 minutes.
You need to drink more wine so you will slow down.
That's your auntie?
No.
Kaylin.
Kaylin.
All right, Kaylin and auntie, where y'all at?
You know, Kaylin's cooking for 17 people.
Yes, Kaylin. I'm cooking for two, not a family of eight, so...
Yeah. No more cute JJ.
What's that? So you should have a couple of sous chefs in the building. Cameron, how you looking on your sauce, buddy?
Yeah, Cam.
Do we bring it back? You happy? Or do we have to get the after class, after hour class?
Brittany said that her salmon is still in the oven. Should she pull it?
Mm-hmm.
Pull it out, Brittany. It should be done.
We don't want dry salmon. I know we got really big on well done and all that. We don't want dry, overcooked salmon.
Sorry, Uncle Paul.
What is that?
They just said your uncle heard that. She's not sure if it's done. So how could she know if it's done or not?
All right. So we'll bring your salmon to the table.
I'm sorry, Lolo.
So a couple things with your salmon. If you have a thermometer, you can take the temperature of the salmon and the stuffing. You can give it the texture feel. It's still firm. And it's bouncing back. It's not leaving any indentions in the salmon. So that means we're cooked throughout. And then over here on this salmon, we started to emit some of the white fats from the salmon, which means it's well done. So you start seeing that fat cooking out of the salmon. And you see how it's flaky right here. We're flaky everywhere. So as long as you got a good texture, you're hot in the middle, you can now lift it up and see that you're hot all the way throughout if you don't have a thermometer. Sorry, guys. A couple glasses of stutter.
Hey, Jeremiah.
Jeremiah, why are you not cooking? Are you still in Myrtle Beach?
Tracy Reeves said that she's watching. Her and her daughter are going to cook next week. Awesome. Tracy, when you cook, take a picture, tag us. How much wine did you add to the rice?
Quarter cup. Well, it also depends. I can't say. So I don't like giving numbers because I don't know how many people. So I did about a cup of rice, and I added a quarter cup of wine. If you have a family of five, if you have 2 to 3 cups of rice, you might need a half cup of wine. But if you're feeding kids, you don't want it too saturated with wine, so you can cut back as well. So there are really a different variations that allows you to make your dish to modify for your family. So once again, we always reiterate, we're teaching to cook dishes and cook meals and not just cook my recipe. I can make a cookbook and give you that. You always will be able to cook my recipe, but I want to give you the skills and the knowledge to cook your own recipe and make variations in how, if your sauce isn't where you want to be, the knowledge and how to fix it and bring it back. So.
Yes, we are sauteing the asparagus. We just kind of slowed down to give our other friends a chance to catch up. So we are about to saute the asparagus.
All right, guys.
What was the temp again? On the salmon, Renee?
In the oven or the internal temperature?
Eternal, probably.
If you're looking for the internal temperature of medium to mid-well, looking at 145, 150. Well done is always 165. But you don't need to eat well done salmon. I won't advise it. I won't lie to you. It's not the best product you can put out.
You said 145.
To 150. All right, saute pan, skillet, medium heat.
Cousin, do you believe in cooking rice by peeking the rice in the middle of boiling water?
Yes.
J. Jeremiah said that he cooked shrimp and grits for breakfast the other day, and it was fire. Can't wait for the next family gathering.
Hey, see, you got another recipe in your arsenal. We got to switch it up, guys. We got to learn how to cook different things when we're at home cooking now. All right.
Shaba. I'm gonna hope I said that right. Hi, Shaba.
Yeah, one of my old cooks.
Oh.
What's up, Shaba? How are you, buddy? So, skillet, medium heat, olive oil. Ooh, you hear it? Why not add as much garlic as you like? 2 tablespoons of garlic. We need that cooking. And we're going to cook this garlic until we get a little color on it. This should be filling your house with amazing smell. Can't go wrong with garlic. Make sure you have enough olive oil to where it is, you can move your garlic around the pan. It's not sticking or burning.
That smells good.
So for those who have put your sauce to the side, please don't forget. We're going to constantly just keep whisking it around. And it should be sitting on low. Guys, we're probably about 1.5, 2 minutes. We're starting to get a little brown, but we're not there yet.
Janae, you could have done halibut. Ken said that would have worked.
Janae, I'm disappointed in you this week. What did my buddy Ryan get to eat this week? So once again, guys, just make sure we have enough oil that your garlic is not sticking in the pot. We can move it around. Like I said, it should be extremely fragrant. Add a little color.
She said, dang it.
And once you start to see your garlic toast and changing colors, getting a little darker, we're going to add our asparagus. And make sure, guys, there's a fine line between cooked garlic and burnt garlic. Burnt garlic is probably one of the most unedible things you can ever eat and get raw in the dish. So we're good. We're toasting.
She said Ryan had halibut piccata.
Oh, okay. Fancy. We're going to add in our asparagus. It's not just for us, guys. Our kids love asparagus, so we'll make something as well. See, now that my garlic is starting to stick to the pan, getting a little tight. I'm not going to add any more oil. I don't want to cook it more, but I'm going to pick that garlic up. So I'm going to add stock and release it from the pan. You see that? That stock. Gets the moisture we need. We're going to cook that asparagus until it's hot throughout. And yes, you will need to touch it and make sure it's the way you like it. Because some people, like my wife and her Uncle Paul, like to eat food at a scalding 200 degrees to where if it doesn't burn your mouth, it's not hot enough. Most humans can't eat it that hot, but that's how they like their food. Ain't that right, Uncle Paul? That's many years of you telling me my soup's not hot enough. All right, guys, so we're going to let that sit a little bit. We're going to season kosher salt, sea salt if you have it, and just pepper. Everything else is seasoned well, so we're just going to go very light, very basic. Salt and pepper and garlic.
He said that's right.
That's all you need on your asparagus, guys. Let me say it with you. And just the chef in me, you see how my asparagus tips are all going the same way. It's very tedious, but at least you know you're cooking the same. So we're not quite hot yet. Do not turn your stove up. Just let it sit in that stock. And then make sure they're all kind of touching the pan.
Hi, Yvonne.
because we want to make sure our asparagus still has flavor. We hate mushy vegetables, guys. You want to make sure it's al dente. When you talk about al dente, it means it's still, it's cooked to the tooth. So even though we're cooking it, we blanched it, it's still not mushy. I'm squeezing it and you still, I'm not making a very small indention on my asparagus. You hate mushy vegetables, guys. Gotta have body, gotta have texture, complexity of the dish. So we're good, we're done. Now we're gonna plate. You have a paper plate? I'm sorry.
Chef, you on one today.
Hey, I'm on three glasses. I'm on fish and bottle by myself.
You on one today.
All right, so we're going to pick up our rice. Make sure it's still hot. I hope you had it sitting on low.
Yep, there we go.
Once again, your portion size depends on your family. I do want to see some plating, guys. Some of y'all had great dishes, and you didn't make it into my top three because you weren't very
Brittany, what's tedious. Wrong? Uh-oh. Why are you OMG-ing?
That's not a spatchy spatch. Get your hand on my asparagus.
I'm hungry.
All right, guys, we're going to pick up the asparagus now. I'm going to make sure that they're all going in the same direction, they're the same length. We're going to set it right on top of that rice. How it kind of sits there. I want some of that garlic as well.
Mm-hmm.
I'm gonna add some of that garlic on there.
That's my plate he's making, y'all. And I love garlic.
Next.
Nakia, hey.
Can you pass me your spatchy spatch?
My spatchy spatch.
Thank you for your spatchy spatch.
I didn't get to stir anything. Asta said her asparagus is dead. Asta, what happened?
We're going to set our salmon right on top of our asparagus. And so, guys, really because we're cooking and we're blanching, I was pretty clear in the shopping list to get jumbo asparagus or as big as you could because we'll be cooking it for a while. If you got pencil asparagus or thin asparagus, it will lose body and it will die quickly. So
that might be what happened, Asta.
But make sure you know what you're purchasing. And sometimes due to the COVID that some of the produce has not been great.
Yeah, she says she overcooked it in the water, yeah. You blanched it. She overboiled it, but
so, guys, sauce. That's that beautiful.
Let me pull back so they can cream. See it. There you go.
We're going to pour it right on top of the salmon. Let it pull down on top of the rice and asparagus. If you feel good, we'll take some of that. You're just going to go around your dish.
So pretty.
We'll finish up with some of that chopped parsley. There you go, guys.
There it is.
There is our Mediterranean stuffed salmon, Chardonnay wild rice, garlic asparagus, and our very own lemon caper cream. So, any questions, any comments? We'll stick around for a while. Like I said, this is a longer class than normal, but we have done quite a few culinary steps that might be new and different to us. So I'm very proud if you stuck with it.
Hi, Sakia. You didn't cook this week?
She can't talk with asparagus in her mouth. Like I said, it's a great dish. I think you'll enjoy every bite of it. A lot of different techniques that we use today. If I move too fast, I'm sorry. I know you're learning and it's something different. But each week, we'll get better. And that way, who knows why we'll be stuck in the house. Some restaurants are opening back up. Some people don't feel comfortable yet, but as long as you're at the house, I'm going to teach you some different recipes and different styles, so that way you're not getting tired of eating the same thing.
Yvonne, that's okay. If you decide to cook it later on, take a picture and tag us. We know people
give us likes, guys. Give us shares. We really appreciate all the support.
all the people spending your money, your time to be with us today on Wednesdays. It's been a great class that we didn't think would grow this much. We definitely appreciate that. Please take a picture, tag us in it. We'll vote on we'll vote on Friday to see who had the best dish. You'll get a Chef Can t-shirt in the mail.
We're going to put names in a pot and draw names at the end of the month for a Chef Can t-shirt.
Oh my gosh. We're still working on that.
Philip Driscoll says, give that man a Michelin star.
Hey, thank you.
Oh, okay, hold on. We got some very competitive aunties that want to see your plate again. There y'all go. All right. Nobody else has any questions? Oh, wait, sorry. I was ending prematurely.
She ready to eat, guys. I can't blame her. All right, so once again, please take a picture, tag us. Thank you for your support. We'll continue to do the free cooking classes on Wednesdays, so thank you. If you enjoyed yourself, you're enjoying this class, it's helping you out, you don't mind sending a tip, Cash App is on the screen. $Chef Ken Rob. We appreciate everything, anything and everything that you've given us. Thank you for the continued support. Like I said, every Wednesday we'll be doing something different. If you have any idea or something you want to learn about, whether it be a protein, a sauce, a vegetable, or a starch, please send me some comments. Everything we've done for the last 3 weeks have been requested by certain people. So thank you again. We appreciate that. If you have any more questions, I'm available on Facebook Messenger or whatever. If you have my number, send me a text. We'll continue to help you out and get your dish the way you like. So we thank y'all. We appreciate y'all, and cheers. Have a good night.